In the first two lectures, we discussed diffuse stars like the Sun. And then in the second lecture, we discussed highly condensed stars. And we convinced ourselves that these condensed stars have to be understood in terms of gravity being supported by a quantum mechanical pressure. In other words, these are quantum objects, just as atoms and molecules are quantum objects. Today, we will discuss stars which are even more compressed, whose mean density is not 1.4 grams per cubic centimeter like the Sun, or 1 million grams per cubic centimeter as a companion of Sirius, but whose density is 10 to the power 14 grams per cubic centimeter. These are the neutron stars. And as per the discussion we have just had of fluctuations and dissipation and their interrelation, if such a highly condensed star has to form, the gravitational potential energy has to be taken away. And that results in the explosion of the star, which is known as a supernova explosion. So that is the subject of today's lecture. Every now and then, the serenity and permanence of the night sky is destroyed by the appearance of a new star in the sky. These stars sometimes last for a few weeks, a few months, sometimes even for a few years. The Chinese, who studied them most meticulously for thousands of years, called them guest stars. If you are in somebody's house as a guest, if you're a good guest, a polite guest, after a while you must leave. You shouldn't stay forever. So these stars appear in the sky and then disappear. Now, these stars were seen as omens of good things as well as bad things. We have all heard 2,000 years ago, there was the star of Bethlehem, which, according to the Bible, signaled, heralded the birth of Jesus. So the Chinese kings were very interested in their learned people in their court, telling them about the appearance and disappearance in a certain constellation, which they called a certain house, of these guest stars. Here, for example, is a Chinese oracle born from 1300 BC. On the seventh day of the month, a great new star appeared in the company of Antares. There were many such guest stars in the last 2,000 years, year 285, 393. The year 1006, there was a very, very bright guest star, which was as bright as a quarter moon, and it was studied not only by the Chinese and Koreans and Japanese, but also by the Middle Eastern astronomers. Then, of course, the most famous guest star of 1054 AD, which we will be discussing. And then in 1572, the great Tycho Brahe saw a guest star. But by this time, and then in 1604, the great Johannes Kepler saw a guest star, which was just 4 years before the telescope was invented. After that, we haven't seen a naked eye guest star in our galaxy. As Fred Hoyle used to say, great stars only appear when there is a great astronomer on Earth. That is his way of taking a dig at contemporary astronomers. There's been no great astronomers since Kepler 400 years ago. Now, the Chinese, and then the guest star of 1054 AD was studied even by the American native Indians, because it is in their cave drawings and their potteries. For a nation which claims we invented everything, not only we invented everything thousands of years before anybody else did, we have not recorded a single guest star in this country. Surely it couldn't have been monsoon for 2,000 years in a row. So it's something to think about why it has not been recorded, because some of them are so bright and we had serious astronomers in this country, they would have surely seen it. For some reason, it was not of interest to them. But the Chinese, for whatever reason, they held a grain of rice at arm's length, and that was a measure of the angular size, so many arc seconds. And so they observed the brighter stars look bigger than dimmer stars. So they recorded how the guest star increased in its brightness and decreased in its brightness. What the hell for? Oh, but that's what science is all about. Okay? They didn't know what it was, but then you record what you see. And then, of course, by the time Tycho Brahe and Johannes Kepler came along, they made very meticulous graphs of the rise and decay of its brightness. And since these stars don't, other stars in the sky, brightness doesn't change very much in the last 500 years, we can go back and put y-axis, the actual brightness. So today we can reconstruct the intensity versus time of these guest stars, thanks to Tycho Brahe and Johannes Kepler. Such a guest star appeared in the constellation Andromeda in the year 1885. In the year 1885, Andromeda was thought to be part of our galaxy. In fact, our galaxy was thought to be the whole universe till 1923. And as soon as Hubble, well, another thing that was noticed was there's no photograph of that because photography was very in its infancy at that time, and astronomical photography was very difficult. But people knew that such a guest star in an external galaxy can be as bright as the whole galaxy put together. In other words, the brightness of the guest star is comparable to the brightness of 10 to the power 11 or 10 to the power 12 stars. And as soon as in 1923, it became clear that the Andromeda galaxy is not part of a galaxy, but it's actually 3 million light years away. Two astronomers in Caltech, Walter Bade on the left and Fred Zwicky. Walter Bade was a German and he studied mathematics with the great Hilbert in Göttingen. And Fritz Zwicky was a theoretical physicist from Switzerland. Both had run away because of the problems arising due to Hitler. And they settled in California Institute of Technology. They realized that if Andromeda galaxy is 3 million light years away, the guest star of Andromeda, if it is as bright as the whole galaxy, the total amount of energy release must be of the order of 10 to the power 52 to 10 to the power 53 X. They made this estimate. So it was that in 1933, paper appeared in the beginning of 1934, one of the most historic papers in the history of astronomy appeared, in which they made the following absolutely extraordinary statements. They said, they coined the phrase supernova. Till then, Tycho Brahe and Johannes Kepler had called these guest stars nova stellae, that means new star in Latin. Bade and Zwicky coined the phrase supernova. Why? Because if it is happening in an external galaxy, the energy release must be an enormous amount of energy. They estimated that the energy released will be almost of the order of mc squared. Because if you take the sun, 10 to the power 33 grams, multiplied by the square of the velocity of light, you will get an energy of the order of 10 to the power 53 ergs. This was astonishing. So they said, if the supernova process, mass in bulk is annihilated. In addition, the hypothesis suggests itself that cosmic rays are produced by supernovae. So let's not discuss that. So what they're saying is, you cannot release 10 to the power 53 ergs in a very short time. Look at the stars, they're only radiating 10 to the power 33 ergs per second, or 10 to the power 34 ergs per second. You're talking about the kind of energy the sun would release in 10 billion years. So they said there cannot be any process. Of course, one didn't know what the process was in stars, but said it cannot be that kind of process. It must be something very drastic. You are annihilating matter in bulk. And then the most historic sentence of the paper, with all reserve, we advance the view that supernovae represent the transition from ordinary stars into neutron stars, which in their final stages consists of extremely closely packed neutrons. So the word neutron star and the word supernovae appear in this paper for the very first time. I don't think I've ever encountered a paper, including paper by Einstein in Relativity and so on, which has as many ideas as in this paper, okay? The paper was very, very short. It was just little more than quarter of a page, that's all. Now, in a picture, this is what they said. They said a gaseous star of a million kilometers or 10 kilometers in radius suddenly collapses to 10 kilometers in radius. When it collapses to 10 kilometers in radius, what you'll have, all the protons have disappeared, all the neutrons, electrons have disappeared. What you'll have are neutrons, and these neutrons will be practically touching one another like ball bearings in a beaker. And you'll have matter whose density will be the density of nucleus, atomic nucleus. Now convince yourself that if you go to the periodic table, the average density of the nucleus, mass divided by the volume of every single element, is of the order of 2 times 10 to the power 14 grams per cubic centimeter. The fact that we float in water is simply because these nuclei are so far apart that the average density is of the order of 1 gram per cubic centimeter. We are all made of matter of density 10 to the power 14 grams per cubic centimeter. And they said the energy released, G m squared over r, and going from the configuration on the left to the configuration on the right, blows up the star, and these are the new stars that we see. Why the star should suddenly collapse, they have nothing to say. How the protons and electrons disappear to become neutrons, they have nothing to say. So it was a shot in the dark, which turned out to be correct. So we don't know if they were right for the wrong reason or if they had some very deep insight. Because you're talking of two very great people. I leave it to you to judge. In the year 1932, one of Rutherford's students, Chadwick, discovered a neutral particle which was given the name neutron. In 1934, Enrico Fermi in Rome advanced the first theory of beta decay. What happens in beta decay is that an atomic nucleus emits electrons, sometimes positrons. Now, we now know that what Enrico Fermi said was that a neutron inside the nucleus decays to a proton and an electron and a neutrino. This neutrino was introduced by Pauli because if you just stopped a neutron decays to proton and electron, then you are not able to satisfy energy and momentum conservation. So they said there must be some invisible particle whose mass is zero but which carries away energy and momentum. And Enrico Fermi called it the neutrino, which in Italian means a little neutral particle. Now, today we know that this should actually be an anti-neutrino. One didn't know that at the time. Now, I would like you to take time to read about this Fermi's theory of beta decay, because it was one of last century's greatest discoveries in theoretical physics. And it was a truly revolutionary thing, because what Fermi said was, see, there are no electrons in the nucleus, as far as we know. There are no neutrinos in the nucleus. So what Fermi actually said was that a neutron decays to a proton and spontaneously an electron and a neutrino are produced and emitted. Just as when an electron jumps from one energy level to another in an atom or a molecule, it produces a photon out of nothing to satisfy energy and momentum and angular momentum conservation. So in the same way, he said this. Now at that time, this was so revolutionary that this paper Fermi submitted to Nature, and Nature rejected this paper. And then a German journal published this paper. Then, of course, it turned out that Fermi was right, and 5 years later, Nature published the paper, even though it had already been published by a German paper. So I would like you to read about this. It'll be in all the standard books on nuclear physics. And to me, there is no doubt that this was one of the greatest theoretical physics discoveries of the 20th century. That Fermi went on to make many such great discoveries is a different matter altogether, but this was a truly profound discovery. Now we go to the year 1938, and the scene shifts from Rome to Moscow. We meet the young theoretical genius, Lev Landau, who was working in the group with Kapitsa. Kapitsa's name we'll encounter later in the lecture. He was working with Rutherford in the Cavendish laboratory, and then he moved to Moscow just around that time. Now, it was Landau who invented neutron stars in the year 1938, and the inspiration for him was the following. In the year 1936, a physicist cum chemist, Hund by the name, introduced the notion of neutron matter, a state in which all the nuclei and electrons have combined to form neutrons. So instead of ordinary matter, you have a neutron matter. But the problem is, in order to have neutron matter, a proton must combine with an electron to form neutrons. Now, this reaction is strongly endothermic. That means it cannot happen spontaneously, because the rest mass energy of the proton on the left-hand side is less than the rest mass energy of the neutron on the right-hand side. So you have to supply energy. How much energy do you have to supply? A hell of a lot of energy. For example, if you want to convert 1 gram of normal matter to neutrons, it'll cost you an astronomical amount of energy, 18 ergs, which is an enormous amount of energy. So what Landau said was, don't panic, you need a lot of energy, but you have a rich uncle who will give you this energy. And that rich uncle is a highly condensed star which has an enormous amount of gravitational binding energy, gm squared over r. So he said, this is not going to happen in our laboratory, but deep in the centers of stars, if the density becomes really high, then the gravitational binding energy acquired in the process of density becoming high, that energy will drive this reaction. Okay, one picture is worth 10,000 words. So this is what is the essence of what Landau said. Normal matter, which he called as electronic matter, as we know, consists of protons and electrons and some neutrons. When the density of matter exceeds a magical value of about 10 to the power 11 grams per cubic centimeter, 4.3 times 10 to the power 11 grams per cubic centimeter, there is a neutronization of matter. What do we mean by neutronization of matter? Protons combine with electrons to form neutrons, and neutrino is emitted, which escapes, carrying away excess energy, angular momentum, etc. The result of this neutronization of matter is you have a small ball of neutrons, which is a neutron matter, whose density is 10 to the power 14 grams per cubic centimeter. So this was Landau's brilliant idea. So neutron stars can be formed. Now we will try to discuss why and how such a situation arises where the density in the center of the star becomes as high as 10 to the power 11 grams per cubic centimeter. Now, where have we encountered densities of the order of 10 to the power 10 grams per cubic centimeter? In the centers of massive white dwarf. If you take a white dwarf whose mass is 1 solar mass, 1.1 solar mass, 1.2 solar mass, and so on, then you find that its central density is of the order of 10 to the power 10 grams or more. So that's where. So if we, in the previous lecture, we talked of Chandrasekhar's great discovery. So if that white dwarf begins to compress, then you will reach a density of 10 to the power 11 grams per cubic centimeter. As we saw, or we will see again, According to the modern picture, what happens when the star evolves and ages? A white dwarf forms at the center. It may be a helium degenerate white dwarf or a carbon degenerate white dwarf or oxygen, whatever it is. Over time, the mass of this white dwarf will increase because more and more hydrogen is being converted to helium, more and more helium is being converted to carbon and so on. So the central white dwarf, its mass is increasing with time. As the mass increases, the central density will increase because according to Chandrasekhar's theory of white dwarf, central density is 6 times the average density, and the average density is proportional to the square of the mass of the white dwarf. So at some stage, the central density reaches 10 to the power 11 grams per cubic centimeter. And at that stage, what happens? Electrons disappear, protons disappear, and neutrons appear. Now, as the electrons disappear, the pressure contributed by the electrons decreases because the pressure of the electron is proportional to density to the power 5 by 3. So, as the number of electrons decreases, the electron pressure decreases. Please remember that in a white dwarf, it is the electron pressure which is balancing gravity. So, as electrons disappear, gravity is becoming stronger. The density will increase. Further, neutronization of matter will get further accelerated. Electrons will disappear even faster. The pressure will decrease even faster. The contraction of the white dwarf will become even faster. So there will be a dynamical collapse. It is a positive feedback. So once you reach a density of 10 to the power 11 grams per cubic centimeter, which will happen when you push the white dwarf above the Chandrasekhar limit, electrons disappear and the white dwarf collapses. Of course, when Chandrasekhar wrote his paper, neutrons had not been discovered. That's why the last sentence of his paper was, one is left speculating on other possibilities. So now we have the possibility that these neutrons, which also obey Fermi-Dirac statistics, at some stage, their pressure can stop gravity, and then you will have a neutron star. So pictorially, Landau's idea is shown here. On the left, you have a normal star, which has a degenerate core, and that degenerate core increases in mass, and when it exceeds the 1.4 solar mass, it collapses, and what you have is the formation of a neutron star in the center, whose radius is about 10 kilometers and density is 10 to the power 14 grams per cubic centimeter. And the amount of energy released, which is gm squared divided by the initial radius minus gm squared divided by the final radius, is of the order of 10% of the rest mass energy, which is an enormous amount of energy, 10 to the power 53 x. It really doesn't matter what the initial radius was, because gm squared divided by 10 kilometers is so much larger than the first term in that equation. It doesn't matter if the initial radius was 1,000,000 kilometers or 1,000 kilometers or 10,000 kilometers. Just as if I drop a stone, most of the potential energy release is as I come closer and closer to the center of the gravitational potential well. And that energy blows apart the star, and then the idea is, we have a supernova explosion. But please remember, this was the year 1938, after Fermi's theory of beta decay, but the paper of Bade and Zucchi preceded Fermi's paper of beta decay. So one is left wondering, how did they say all these things before all these things were known? Okay, so now we will switch our story. In the previous lecture, we concluded that stars up to roughly 9 solar mass, it may be 8, it may be 10 solar mass, end up as degenerate white dwarfs, where gravity is balanced by the quantum mechanical pressure of the electrons. As for the chemical composition, very low mass stars end up as helium white dwarfs, but the overwhelming majority of white dwarfs end up as carbon white dwarfs with a little bit of oxygen, because in that reaction, some oxygen is also formed. When helium fuses, you don't form just carbon, but also a little bit of oxygen is formed. Now we want to ask the question, what is the fate of stars which are more massive than, say, 10 solar mass? So that's the subject of today's lecture. So the fate of massive stars, not the fate of very massive stars, we'll come to that in the last few minutes of this lecture, but the fate of stars, say 10, 15, 20, 22, 23 solar mass. Now, first thing I want you to appreciate is that the fate of massive stars is very different from the evolution of low mass stars which we discussed in the previous lecture. What did we say in the previous lecture? We said that when a star transmutes element at the center, hydrogen to helium, helium to carbon, etc., at some stage, that inert core becomes degenerate. That cannot happen in a massive star. In other words, it never becomes degenerate. In other words, Boyle's law never breaks down. When do you say Boyle's law breaks down? You say Boyle's law is valid when KT is much greater than EF. So what we are now going to say is that in massive stars, KT never becomes smaller than EF. The density is increasing. EF is increasing as density to the power 2 by 3. But KT is increasing even faster. Why? That is due to the role played by radiation pressure. Now, as I said in the very first lecture, one of Eddington's great insights was that as you go to more and more massive stars, radiation pressure becomes more and more important. In other words, the total pressure is the sum of gas pressure plus radiation pressure. In a star like the Sun, radiation pressure is 10% or so. You can safely ignore it. But if you go to stars that we are talking about, 10, 15, 20 solar mass, radiation pressure dominates over gas pressure. So why, what has that got to do with the price of fish? If radiation pressure is more, let it be more. That is between gravity and radiation pressure. What has that got to do with whether matter becomes degenerate or not? Okay? So that was the great insight and one of Chandrasekhar's greatest contributions. And that was in a paper in 1932. He was 21 years old when he wrote the paper, appeared in 1932. But the work was done in 1931. In 1931, he took a few months off and went from Cambridge to Copenhagen to Niels Bohr's Institute. That's where everybody went. That was the Mecca of physics. Pauli was there, Weisskopf was there, Rosenfeld was there, Landau was there, all the budding geniuses, they all migrated towards Niels Bohr because Niels Bohr was the sort of person who guided them like Gauss did in mathematics 50 years earlier, okay? And when he made this discovery, he sent it to a journal, to a German journal, and unfortunately, that paper was sent to Sir Arthur Milne in England for refereeing. And Milne didn't like this idea because he was promoting an idea that all stars have degenerate cores. According to this idea, not all stars can have degenerate cores. Really massive stars don't have degenerate cores. So he said this paper shouldn't be published, but he wrote to Chandrasekhar a private letter saying that, look, if you publish this paper, your reputation is going to be seriously and permanently damaged because this is wrong. However, I am going to allow the journal to publish this paper. Milne was wrong, Chandrasekhar was right, and this was one of the most profound papers that he wrote in that phase. And it is because of this paper and the result of this paper that Eddington rejected the very notion of the Chandrasekhar limiting mass, which I quoted last time, which we will see once again. So what did Chandrasekhar do in this paper? So please follow this. You will seldom find this in books. You'll seldom find people discussing this, but it is a very deep and profound idea. What he said was, if the radiation pressure exceeds a magical value of 9.2% of the total pressure, then matter will never become degenerate, no matter how large the density may become. KT will always remain larger than EF. You have to prove this. And he proved it in this paper in a mathematically exact manner. So this is an exact mathematical theorem. When do you say gas obeys ideal gas law? When KT is much greater than EF. Or equivalently, the pressure calculated according to the classical formula, which is Boyle's law, is numerically greater than the pressure calculated according to the Fermi-Dirac law, which is the degeneracy pressure. Okay? But there is a problem. If you want to compare the ideal gas pressure with degeneracy pressure, it is like comparing apples and oranges. You can't compare apples and oranges. They are different fruits. So why do I say that? So let us look at this. Let us look at this equation. What is inside the bracket, on the second term on the in that equation, is Boyle's law pressure. It depends rho kT by the mass of the particle. So the classical pressure depends on density as well as temperature. Whereas the radiation pressure depends only on temperature. So how can you compare the two? You can't compare the two. Now, you can if you do the following trick. So what Chandrasekhar did was to introduce a fraction beta. What is this? Beta is a number. 1%, 2%, 50%, whatever it is. What is beta? Beta times the total pressure is gas pressure. In other words, beta is the fraction of the total pressure contributed by gas pressure. 1 minus beta is the pressure contributed by radiation pressure to the total pressure. Okay, 1 beta plus 1 minus beta is 1. So sum of gas pressure plus radiation pressure is the total pressure. So be clear in your mind, beta is a fraction which represents the fraction contributed by gas pressure to total pressure, and 1 minus beta is the fraction contributed by radiation pressure to the total pressure. Okay, fine. Now, I'm going to compare the second term of this equation with the third term. So I rewrite it here. So I'm going to compare 1 over beta rho kT divided by mu mp equal to 1 over 1 minus beta 1 by 3 at to the power 4. Now you see, the left-hand side is a function of rho and t. The right-hand side is a function of only t and beta. So I can solve for temperature in terms of the density and the fraction beta. It is just a trick. We haven't done anything. There is no physics insight or anything. It's just a trick. I have, instead of using temperature as a variable, I can use rho and beta as a variable. Okay. Now I substitute this T in terms of rho and the square bracket into Boyle's law. So you find gas pressure, which is rho kT divided by mu mp, becomes rho into k into t, which is this animal over here. Please write this down, because you won't find this formula very easily in books. So gas pressure, instead of rho kT divided by mu mp, can be written in terms of density to the power 4 by 3. Where did 4 by 3 come from? There is already rho to the power 1 in Boyle's law. T is proportional to rho to the power 1 by 3. So it becomes rho to the power 4 by 3. And a function C of beta, which is the square bracket over here. What have I done? Write the classical pressure instead of rho and rho times T. I have written it as some function of beta times rho. Please remember, degeneracy pressure depends only on density. So now, I'm not comparing apples with apples. I'm comparing two different kinds of apples. Both are proportional to rho to the power 4 by 3. So once again, if classical pressure of the electron is greater than degeneracy pressure, then gas will be classical. What is the gas pressure? Rho kT by the mass of the particle, which we have now written as C of beta times rho to the power 4 by 3. Beta is a number which represents the gas pressure divided by the total pressure. What is the degeneracy pressure? Relativistic degeneracy pressure. Because when we are talking of very massive stars, we are talking of very high densities. If matter does become degenerate, it will be relativistically degenerate. So I shouldn't put rho to the power 5 by 3, I should put rho to the power 4 by 3. Now I can compare these two, because both are proportional to rho only. Temperature is gone. It is expressed in terms of beta. Okay, fine. So let's rewrite this. Therefore, the condition that classical pressure is greater than degeneracy pressure is that this value of this pressure is greater than the value of this pressure. Rho to the power 4 by 3 cancels out on two sides. So what you are left with is this square bracket, which is C of beta, is greater than K2, where K2 is the proportionality constant which comes in degeneracy pressure, relativistic degeneracy pressure, which we wrote down in the last lecture. Now, this can be simplified because you know value of Boltzmann's constant, mu is 2, you know the value of Stefan's constant, mass of the proton, so this can be solved. And this inequality corresponds to 1 minus beta greater than 0.092. In other words, if radiation pressure, which is 1 minus beta times the total pressure, is greater than 9.2% of the total pressure, then classical pressure is always greater than quantum pressure, KT is always greater than EF, and the matter does not become degenerate, however high the density may become. This theorem is an exact theorem. There are no approximations made whatsoever. So if radiation pressure exceeds 9.2% of the total pressure, degeneracy never sets in. Therefore, more massive the star, greater is the fraction contributed by radiation pressure. So at some mass, radiation pressure will be 9.2% of the total pressure. And for all greater masses, radiation pressure will be more than 9.2% of it. And therefore, for those stars, degeneracy will never set in. And the star will find itself in a very serious situation when finally its nuclear reactor stops and everything is being converted to iron. Previously, that iron became degenerate and you became a white dwarf, as we will see. But now it will not become degenerate. So when the heat supply of heat goes away, the original 1925 fear of Eddington will come true. The star cannot find peace. It'll just go on collapsing and collapsing and disappear. And this is why Eddington rejected Chandrasekhar's discovery. This is why he said, there must be a law of nature to prevent a star behaving in such an absurd manner. This is what he meant. Okay, we'll see this in more detail. So, one picture is worth 10,000 words. Let's go through this derivation now graphically. What is plotted on the y-axis is the logarithm of the pressure. What is plotted on the x-axis is the logarithm of the density. There is a sloping line here, which is the degeneracy pressure due to the electrons. At lower densities, up to some several million grams per cubic centimeter, the degeneracy will be non-relativistic. In other words, the pressure will be proportional to density to the power 5 by 3. Therefore, that blue line will have a slope of 5 by 3. At very high densities, it will have a slope of 4 by 3, which is relativistic degeneracy. So the regime to the left of this line, gas is classical. The regime to the right of the line, the gas is quantum mechanical. Okay, fine. Now, let us plot the ideal gas pressure for a gas where radiation pressure is 2% and gas pressure is 98%. Beta is 0.98. What is the pressure? What is the equation for that ideal gas pressure? It is C of beta into rho to the power 4 by 3. So that red line will also have a slope of 4 by 3, which is the slope of the relativistic line. So what this tells you is, for example, when the gas pressure is 98% and radiation pressure is 2%, for low densities, the gas is, the red line is above. That means the classical pressure is more than the quantum pressure, and therefore the gas is classical. But at high densities, the degeneracy pressure is greater than the classical pressure, therefore the gas becomes degenerate. Very good. Now let us go to a gas whose radiation pressure is exactly 9.2% of the total pressure. And that is the dashed line, where beta is 0.908. That means the radiation pressure is 9.2%. So you see that that line coincides with the relativistic degeneracy line beyond a certain density. Therefore, the gas never becomes degenerate. So if I go to, if I increase the radiation pressure a little more to 50%, then you see that the gas never becomes classical, I mean quantum mechanical. The classical pressure always stays above the quantum mechanical pressure. Okay, is that clear? So let's go backwards. So 2%, gas pressure is 2%, radiation pressure is 2%, radiation pressure is 9.2%, radiation pressure is 50%. So if you go beyond 9.2%, this figure is actually from Chandrasekhar's 1932 paper. I've sort of slightly adapted it to make it easier to draw in PowerPoint, but it's from that paper. So the conclusion in that paper, the final sentence of that paper, is a prophetic statement. For all stars above a critical mass, the perfect gas equation of state does not break down, however high the density may become, and matter does not become degenerate. This is the killer sentence. An appeal to Fermi-Dirac statistics to avoid the central singularity cannot be made. In stars less than the critical mass, Fermi-Dirac statistics takes over and the gas becomes degenerate and it saves the star. And he says you can't appeal to Fermi-Dirac statistics to save the star if it is above a critical mass, because degeneracy will never set in. This is what Eddington meant by saying Dr. Chandrasekhar had obtained the result earlier, but in his recent paper he has rubbed it in. This is what he meant. This is what Eddington was very upset about. So, here it is pictorially to summarize everything I've said so far. Again, here, what is on the y-axis is the logarithm of the central temperature, and what is on the x-axis is the logarithm of the central density. Left side of this diagram, classical gas reigns supreme, and right of the sloping rectangular box, the gas is degenerate. And what is that sloping box? When does classical become quantum? When KT becomes equal to EF. For low densities, KT is density to the power 2 by 3. So the slope of the rectangular box is 2 by 3. For high density, when the gas is relativistic, Fermi energy is density to the power 1 by 3. So the slope is 1 by 3. So the core of a low mass star, which is shown in blue, will be initially classical. At some density, KT becomes smaller than EF and the gas becomes degenerate, and then the star ends up as a white dwarf. The statement is the core of a star more massive than a critical value never becomes degenerate, and it is doomed when its supply of subatomic energy fails, as Eddington said in 1925. So such stars will become points, singularities. along the way, you lose communication with it, and we will today say it will become a black hole. Black holes are perfectly harmless objects. You just don't see them. If I turn off the light in this room, you can't see me. It's no big deal. Fact that, you know, what is serious? The star disappearing from this universe. That's what Eddington saw long before anybody else saw. Okay? Now, what I've shown in this diagram, we won't dwell on this. It's again the same plot, logarithm of the central temperature to logarithm of the central density. The dashed xeon line delineates the classical behavior on the left and the quantum behavior on the right. And those dashed yellow line, green line, and xeon line are the combination of density and temperature, where hydrogen will start fusing to helium, helium will start fusing to carbon, carbon will start fusing to oxygen, neon, magnesium, etc. So what we are saying is that in a sufficiently massive star, say a 15 solar mass star, the gas is classical when hydrogen ignites, gas remains classical when helium ignites, when carbon ignites, oxygen ignites, and so it's perfectly okay. Remember, as long as the gas is classical, there is a safety valve and it won't blow itself apart. If it becomes, if it ignites in a degenerate fashion, it'll blow itself apart, as I tried to explain to you last time. So if you were to go and look at the center of a 15 solar mass star or a 20 solar mass star or a 25 solar mass star, deep in the center, it is still all hydrogen, but deep in the center, you'll have something like an onion. One sphere inside another sphere inside another sphere. So what you'll have starting from outside is hydrogen is being converted to helium, and then further in, helium to carbon, and then carbon to neon, oxygen, magnesium, and so on. So finally, silicon being converted to iron. Right in the center, you have an inert iron core. It is still classical. Why is it classical? Till then, why didn't the safety valve break down and the star explodes itself? Because of the following reason. What I'm saying is, the core remains non-degenerate during successive stages of nuclear burning, so that finally, up to iron, the nuclear cycle has proceeded. Why has it remained? It has remained classical because the the radiation pressure at all these stages has always remained more than 9.2% of the total pressure. Why? Why the hell didn't this gas cool down? It didn't cool down because cooling down is mainly due to the emission of photons. But as the gas gets denser and denser, the mean free path of the photon becomes smaller and smaller. Therefore, cooling due to the emission of radiation is very inefficient. So radiation pressure always remains more than 9.2% of the total pressure. Something magical happens when silicon fuses to iron, because you now reach a temperature of 10 to the power 10 Kelvin at the center. When you go to a temperature of 10 to the power 10 Kelvin, due to various new reactions, neutrinos are produced in very large numbers. The neutrino luminosity of the star becomes much, much larger than the photon luminosity of the star. Neutrinos escape. The mean free path of the neutrino is many light years. If you had a cylinder of lead, neutrinos will go several light years without being scattered. So suddenly you have a new channel for cooling. You don't depend upon these miserable photons which are struggling to escape. Even in the sun it took 30,000 years, but here you're talking of very high densities, 10 to the power 10 grams per cubic centimeter. So that is why, what are the new neutrino processes that appear? I have listed four neutrino processes. Now, These are not neutrino processes that Enrico Fermi could have written down in 1934. These neutrino processes are processes that are allowed only because of the Salam, Weinberg, Glashow unified electroweak theory. Certain reactions which were not allowed before are now allowed. And these neutrinos are produced in very large numbers. The neutrino luminosity is many millions of times the photon luminosity, and therefore the iron core quickly cools. And at some stage it becomes degenerate. And so you have an iron white dwarf. So since neutrinos escape easily, cooling becomes efficient, radiation pressure suddenly drops below 9.2% of the total pressure, and the iron core becomes degenerate. Its density is 10 to the power 10 grams per cubic centimeter. Its size is about 1,000 kilometers, is what calculations show. These are calculations done in the 1970s. But it's all because of a paper that was written in 1932. Now, what happens is the star has evolved for 10 million years, going from hydrogen at the center of the onion to silicon at the center of the onion. When at the center of the onion, iron forms, the story ends within a few hours, 8 to 10 hours. Okay? It's like in the old Indian movies, it'll go on for 4 hours. Finally, in the last 10 minutes, there'll be dramatic convergence of everything, right? And then there is a dynamical collapse when the mass reaches 1.4 times the solar mass. So you have a bucket in the center of the star. If you fill the bucket, the mass of the iron is 1.4 solar mass. It is degenerate. So the next instant, the bottom drops out. And the white dwarf collapses. And the result of the collapse is the formation of a neutron star. What will be the mass of the neutron star? 1.4 times the mass of the sun. Because that's when the dynamical collapse sets in. Therefore, the neutron star which is formed, the prediction of this theory is, it'll have a mass which is equal to the maximum mass of a white dwarf, which is 1.4 solar mass. See, the iron core is degenerate, so it's an iron white dwarf. Forget what it is made of, its mu is 2. So when the mass reaches 1.4 solar mass, it must collapse. Okay, so according to this scenario, this is how nature makes white dwarfs. And when it does make white dwarf, its mass will necessarily be 1.4 solar mass. I mean, you could go to a supermarket and buy neutron stars of different masses made in a factory, but that's not the way star makes it. If you're talking of neutron stars in nature, they should have a mass of 1.4 solar mass. So this neutron star should have a mass of 1.4 solar mass. Why dynamical instability? Over time, an iron white dwarf forms and its mass will increase. As the mass increases, the central density will increase. And when the central density reaches 10 to the power 11 grams per cubic centimeter, protons will combine with electrons to form neutrons. Electrons disappear, degeneracy pressure will drop because that depends upon the number of electrons. This will lead to contraction of the core, resulting in an acceleration of the neutronization of matter, and there will be a positive feedback resulting in a dynamical collapse in a few milliseconds. That's the free fall time, according to Newton's law. So in a couple of milliseconds, it'll collapse. Now here is what calculations show about the details of the collapse. So what is shown on the left is this collapsing iron core, whose mass is 1.4 times the mass of the sun. It's a collapsing white dwarf. Now what you see here is the inner regions of the core collapses faster. It collapses homologously. Homologous means if I have a star of mass m and radius r. If I compress it to a different radius r prime, then you have to ask, if there is a certain mass in a certain shell, same fraction should be here. In other words, it's a homologous contraction. So what calculation, detailed computer calculation shows is that the inner part of the core collapses homologously. But the outer part of the core is in free fall. So the outer part is collapsing slowly and the inner part is collapsing fast. What will the inner part do? It will reach the nuclear density. I compress a tennis ball and let go. What will it do? It will bounce back because I've not taken away the binding energy. So is this clear? This took a long time. This picture became clear only in the 1990s. The story started in 1930s. So the core collapses. Even as the outer portion of the core is collapsing, the inner portion of the core has already collapsed and it's bounced back because you haven't taken away the energy. You haven't found a mechanism to take away the energy. So here it's shown pictorially once again. And so what happens is, as the inner core bounces back, it finds the outer core still falling in. So this results in a shock wave, like when you exceed the speed of sound in a fluid. Now people thought that it is the shock wave that blows the star apart, which has required energy, and that energy came from the binding energy. Therefore, in the center, that collapsing core decided to settle down as a neutron star. So that's the point. The iron core collapses, forms a neutron star of 1.4 solar mass, and the binding energy results in the explosion. But it didn't work. They tried this for 20, 30 years with Cray computers and so on. Some essential physics was missing. The shock, yes, there was a shock wave, but the shock stalled. So it's like your Diwali cracker, which doesn't explode. Only the wick burns and then nothing happens. So they were stuck for 10, 15, 20 years till Hans Bethe, by the time almost 90 years old, supplied the essential physics. He said, boys, look, the gravitational binding energy is mostly released as neutrinos because 10 to the power 57 protons have been converted to 10 to the power 57 neutrons, or 10 to the power 57 neutrinos have been emitted. And you all said the neutrinos will escape. Their mean free path, as I said, is light years long. That is true under normal densities. But if you're talking of a density of 10 to the power 14 grams or 10 to the power 13 grams or 10 to the power 12 grams per cubic centimeter, and if you say neutrinos obey Salam, Weinberg, Glashow, electro weak theory, then he said their mean free path will be very, very small. Neutrinos will not escape. So neutrinos are like photons. They are trapped inside. So let me explain this. So what you have is the outer core is still falling in. This is a silicon burning shell. Silicon is still being converted to iron, and the rest of the star is here, many millions of kilometers in length. The inner core collapsed and bounced back. Inner core collapsed to form a neutron star. Neutrinos were emitted. But these neutrinos are struggling. They are doing random walk like the photons do in the star. So the neutrinos are trapped inside a volume which is small compared to the volume of the core. And that is the neutrino photosphere, just as the photosphere of the sun is the region inside which the photons are essentially trapped. And from that photosphere, neutrinos escape at the speed of light. So the final story by the year 2000 of how a supernova explosion occurs is this. Namely, neutrinos, which was always thought to be something which just escaped, actually caused the bomb. It's the neutrinos which supply pressure. Well, how much is the pressure? 1/3 AT^4. So in other words, the neutrinos behave like photons in an opaque body because the core is opaque. Okay? So finally it turned out, and when people included this physics, which was first pointed out by Hans Bethe at the ripe age of 90 or so, the star did explode. So there is reason to believe that we finally got the, put our finger on the correct physics. So when the star explodes, and the shock emerges from the surface of the star, the luminosity of the star increases enormously. These are the guest stars being born. So what you see on the left, on the vertical axis, is the luminosity of the object in a logarithmic scale, and the x-axis is the time in days, 120 days, 150 days, and so on. So you see this guest star is bright and shining for 300 days, 400 days. You'll say, where is the energy coming from? For the light, I mean, because the neutrinos finally have escaped, right? After blowing apart the star, when they reach the photosphere, they'll escape. Well, it is due to radioactivity. When did the action stop? When iron was produced. When you produce iron, you also produce some nickel and cobalt. They belong to the same group. Nickel is radioactive. Cobalt is radioactive. Their radioactive decay timescale, half-life, is very, very long. So this decay of the light from a supernova over years is due to energy continued to be supplied by radioactive nickel and radioactive cobalt. You see them in the spectrum. So what is shown here is the spectrum of the ejecta of a supernova. Don't look at all the details. So the star has exploded, and this debris is flying apart at enormous speed. And then you can send that light through a prism or a grating or whatever it is. So I'll just show you some lines. There's iron here, magnesium here, helium, calcium, oxygen, everything is there, okay? So there's a whole industry trying to analyze the spectra to really figure out the ratio of abundances of elements that were synthesized in the star. Okay, and during the explosion. Because it's during the explosion, you form elements which are heavier than iron, because there are still a lot of neutrons there. So by neutron capture, you form these really heavy elements, almost all of which are radioactive. So what are the theoretical predictions of this scenario, whose origin really goes back to 1930, 1932, 1934? The theoretical predictions are three, and very clear and very firm. The first prediction is there should be a burst of neutrinos from the explosion of the star, because the collapse, dynamical collapse of the iron white dwarf happened in a millisecond or so. So these neutrinos are emitted in that time scale. And how much energy should they carry? 10^53 eggs are a good fraction of it. Very clear prediction. The second clear prediction is neutron stars should be found at the centers of the remnants of supernovae that exploded hundreds of thousands of years ago. Right? So if you look at the debris of the star that exploded and which was seen by Tycho Brahe or Kepler, at the center you should find a neutron star, if all this is correct. Not only you should find a neutron star, the mass of the neutron star should be 1.4 times the mass of the sun. So these things were said based on very simple and yet very compelling physics considerations long time ago, long before nuclear physics came, let alone particle physics, let alone electro weak theory and so on. Right? So let's look at the first thing. On 23rd of February 1987, the star, which is shown at the end of the arrow on the picture on the right, exploded. This supernova was first seen by a car mechanic in New Zealand, who was an amateur astronomer. He knew the southern sky, And suddenly he saw there's a new star there, which he hadn't seen the previous day. And then, of course, he alerted all the observatories, and what they saw was the picture on the left. The star had exploded. In fact, its spectrum was taken just the previous day, on the 22nd of February 1987, the spectrum of the star was taken routinely by astronomers. Now, when a neutron star is formed, roughly 10 to the power 57 neutrinos are emitted, carrying away roughly 10 to the power 53 ergs. Have we found them? Yes. In Kamiokande mine in Japan, 2 kilometers underground in the mountains, there was a giant neutrino detector made with water to detect neutrinos from the sun. Because till you detected the neutrinos from the sun, you don't know whether all this fusion reaction story is right or wrong. So there was this big exercise worldwide, and the most sophisticated detector was built in Kamiokande in Japan. And then on the 23rd of February 1987, they found a burst of neutrinos. And the time of that burst coincided with the time of the light flash. And the direction in which the neutrinos came from pointed to the large Magellanic cloud in the southern sky where the supernova occurred. How do you tell? It's hard enough to detect neutrinos. It took 25 years to detect the neutrino the first time. How do you tell where it came from? So it's a beautiful physics. I don't have time to look in the video of one of the earlier lectures, the solar neutrino puzzle lecture that I gave last year. The idea is the following. A neutrino comes and encounters an electron in the detector, and it accelerates the electron. Let us say this electron, thicker line. And the velocity of this electron exceeds the phase velocity of light in water. Therefore, this electron emits radiation predominantly in the forward direction, and that radiation is known as Cherenkov radiation. And that radiation, like shock waves in a fluid, if a bullet is shot through air at a speed greater than the speed of sound, it creates a shock wave which propagates predominantly in the forward direction. Same thing happens when a particle moves faster than the phase velocity of light in the medium. It will emit radiation, which instead of expanding in all 4 pi directions, is confined to a very narrow cone. And it is this Cherenkov of light which is detected by a photomultiplier. So the direction in which it came tells me the direction in which the neutrinos came. Direction in which the photons hit the photon. You had a huge sphere surrounding water. The sphere was covered with thousands of photomultiplier tubes. So what you found is a circle of photomultipliers lighting. The circle of photomultipliers is the radius of the Cherenkov cone when it hit the sphere of the detector, and that is pointing towards the large Magellanic cloud. Okay, therefore, the neutrino prediction was confirmed, and the Nobel Prize was given to the leader of the Japanese team which detected the neutrinos. Second prediction is, neutron stars should be found at the centers of the debris of explosion that happened hundreds and thousands of years ago. Here is the debris of the star that exploded in the year 1054 AD, the most famous supernova explosion. And there at the center is the neutron star. This is the X-ray image from the Chandra Observatory. So you do find neutron stars at the center of explosions of massive stars. Is this the only case? No, this is not the only case. This is the star that exploded in the year 1680 in the constellation Cassiopeia, very spectacular supernova remnant. It is still expanding very, very fast with a speed of about 6,000 kilometers a second. And there is a neutron star in the center, discovered by the Chandra Observatory. This is black body X-rays emitted by the neutron star because its surface temperature is about 10 million degrees. A 10 million degree black body will radiate with a peak coming in soft X-rays. Many examples are known. Have you measured the masses of neutron stars? Here are very accurately determined masses of neutron stars, and that is 1.4 solar mass. So I submit to you all the three predictions that were made in the 1930s have been spectacularly confirmed by observations. It took a long time, but it has been confirmed. What we have discussed so far is the explosion of a massive star, 10, 15, 20, 21, 22 times the mass of the sun. Now, there are many kinds of explosions of stars, and astronomers are very imaginative people. They're called type 1, type 2, okay? Very clever in naming them. And then if you find that it doesn't fit into one, you say type 1A, type 1B, type 1C, type 2L, 2P, and so on, okay? So we won't get into all that phenomenology, I promised you. So I will say, for the purpose of this lecture, that the explosions of massive stars results in type 2 supernova. Why are they concerned with, why are they giving it further names? Why is type 1 different from type 2 and so on? What astronomers are really trying to say is that when I take the spectrum of this expanding ejecta from the explosion, what are the elements which are predominant in this ejecta? In type 2 supernova, the predominant element is hydrogen. In our scenario, you wouldn't expect it to be hydrogen because most of the star is still hydrogen. So if you look at the spectrum, the strongest lines will be H alpha, H beta, H gamma, H delta. You see all of them in the spectrum that I showed before, not just one of them, okay? But then the other supernova explosion, where there is no hydrogen. There is helium and heavier elements, absolutely zero hydrogen. Now, these are massive stars in a binary system, which we will discuss in a later lecture, where this star gave all the hydrogen to the companion star and then went on to explode. So what you will find is only helium and heavier elements. That's why there is different kinds of supernovae, okay? So in type 1 supernova, for example, which I want to discuss very briefly now, there is no hydrogen. You find iron, nickel, cobalt, and things like that. No hydrogen, no helium, nothing. So I just want you to know there are many different kinds of explosions of stars. And they can be broadly grouped into explosions of massive stars, with various subtle differences and variations. But what I want to tell you is that there is another kind of supernova, which is called type 1 supernova. And it's actually called type 1A supernova because astronomers also have type 1B supernova, which is a supernova where there is no hydrogen but only helium. This is a different thing. That's why it's called type 1A. Now, type 1A supernovae have nothing to do with massive stars, nothing to do with stellar evolution, formation of a degenerate iron core, collapse of a white dwarf which has reached Chandrasekhar mass. It has to do with two white dwarfs going around each other and finally merging. How those white dwarfs are formed is due to this stellar story. But these two white dwarfs happen to be in a binary system because their parent stars happen to be in a binary system. We will discuss binary system in one of the purpose of this series is to take you towards binary systems. Okay, so what happens is that under certain circumstances, two stars in a binary system evolve and both of them produce. The story ends with white dwarfs. Maybe they're carbon, oxygen, white dwarfs. Because the center never became hot enough for further stages of nuclear burning. So you never went up to iron. And then due to emission of gravitational radiation, the two white dwarfs came closer and closer and closer, and finally they merged. When two white dwarfs of, say, one solar mass and one solar mass merge, the total mass is two solar masses. So you can't have a white dwarf of two solar mass, that's more than 1.4 solar mass, so that will collapse as soon as they merge. And you will have an explosion, like we did so far. That is type 1a supernova. Okay? Now, emission of gravitational waves, which we want to discuss from neutron stars, which has been detected 2 years ago, is due to two neutron stars already born in a very close binary. Therefore, within 100 million years, they can spiral in. These white dwarfs are very far apart. So in 100 million years, is like day before yesterday, nothing will happen. So they will need billions of years. So this kind of supernova is very rare, extremely rare. What will happen when these two neutron stars merge? We don't know. That depends on something we will discuss in later lecture. What is the maximum mass a neutron star is allowed to have? If the neutron star is allowed to have, let's say, two 1.4 solar mass neutron stars, say 1.3, so total mass will be 2.6. So I'll have a neutron star of 2.6 solar mass. Yes, there's explosion and all that remaining, fine. But are you allowed to have a neutron star of 2.6 solar mass? If so, fine. It'll be a neutron star. But suppose you're not allowed to have neutron stars of 2.6 solar mass, then that neutron star will collapse and the resultant object will be a black hole. Okay? So far, observationally, we do not know whether at the centers of type 1a supernovae, whether we have a neutron star, a massive neutron star, or a black hole. Okay, that you people can look forward to that in your lifetime. Now, what is plotted here on the left are luminosity versus time of several type 1a supernovae. Now, these supernovae are at various distances. They are in external galaxies, and those galaxies are at different distances. Therefore, to really go from the observed intensity to the supernova, you have to bring in distance. And if you do all that properly and adjust for distances and other things, variation, you find, like in law of corresponding states in thermodynamics, all these supernovae fall on a single curve. This is not true for type 2 supernovae. So type 1a supernovae are standard candles. At their maximum, their luminosities are the same. Therefore, if I see a type 1a supernova in a distant galaxy and measure its intrinsic, the measured intensity at its maximum, I also know the luminosity, therefore I know the distance to this galaxy. So in the last 15 years, type 1a supernovae have become an important, profoundly important distance calibrator for the very distant galaxies. And therefore, type 1a supernovae are extremely important in cosmology today. It is by studying these type 1 supernovae, people came to the conclusion that the universe is accelerating. Okay? The acceleration of the universe was discovered by studying very distant supernovae. That's a different story. We don't have time to go into that. When the star explodes, what happens to the debris? As we said, when a massive star explodes, the remnant is only 1.4 solar mass. So much of the mass, 5, 10, 15, 20 solar mass, is ejected back into the interstellar medium. And that matter is expanding very, very fast. For example, on the first day, on 23rd February 1987, when the star in the Magellanic Cloud exploded, Indian Institute of Astrophysics Observatory in Bangalore near Jolapet, they measured a velocity from H alpha line, Doppler velocity, of almost 20,000 kilometers a second. They're not relativistic, but pretty fast, 20,000 kilometers a second. And the kinetic energy of the ejector, which is half mv squared, is of the order of 10 to the power 51 ergs. So please notice that the energy carried away as kinetic energy of the debris is a very small fraction of the energy released when a neutron star is formed. That's all taken away as neutrinos. But there is enough energy in the debris that it's still staggering 10 to the power 51 ergs. And this is what, very close to what Bader and Zwicky estimated in 1934. Now, this expanding blast wave, 20,000 kilometers a second, 10,000 kilometers a second, 5,000 kilometers a second, 2,000 kilometers a second, is still larger than the speed of sound in the gas between the stars. So there is a shock wave. So what you see here is the expanding debris of a star that exploded a long time ago. And we see hundreds and hundreds of them in our galaxy. This debris will expand for hundreds and thousands of years. And just as a bulldozer, as it accumulates more and more snow or earth, slows down due to momentum conservation, similarly, this expanding blast wave, as it sweeps the matter between the stars, will slow down. First, it will expand according to Newton's first law. Then it will slow down, conserving energy and then momentum. And finally, it will come to a stop when the pressure of this piston is equal to the external pressure of the medium into which it is expanding. By that time, its size will be many, many light years, tens or hundreds of light years. So here is the expanding debris of the star that exploded in 1987. You see it in millimeter visible X-rays. Here is the debris of the explosion that happened 1,000 years ago, 1054 AD. This is an optical image plus other wavelengths. This is a radio emission. We will come to this in the next lecture or so. This emission is due to electrons spiraling in a magnetic field, relativistic electrons spiraling in a magnetic field, which is called synchrotron radiation. So what you have is a giant bubble of the ejecta of the exploded star and a blast wave preceding it, moving faster than the speed of sound in the medium. And what is inside this blast wave cavity, is gas whose temperature is 10 million degrees. Because when gas is swallowed up by this expanding piston, it acquires energy, fraction of the energy of the kinetic energy. And then if you look at this problem carefully, you come to the conclusion that its temperature is about 10 million degrees, so you should see it in X-rays. Here is an X-ray image, Chandra image, of the expanding debris of the guest star that Tycho Brahe saw in 1572. This is an X-ray image. Here is the X-ray image of the star that exploded in the year 1006, studied by the Arab astronomers in great detail. Here is Cassiopeia A supernova remnant. X-rays in blue. This is just X-rays, okay, Chandra image. So everything that you see here is X-ray intensity in this. Now, the ejecta consists not only of elements synthesized in the star during the various stages of nuclear fusion, it also contains elements heavier than iron. As we said before, these heavy elements are formed during the supernova explosion by neutron capture. Look in nuclear physics books, you will find what are these elements. Therefore, studying the chemistry of the ejecta is very important. How much of each element there is. Unfortunately, because the elements are very hot, ejecta is very hot, you cannot do optical spectroscopy, infrared spectroscopy. You have to do spectroscopy in X-rays because it's predominantly emitting X-ray. So one had to wait for X-ray astronomy to come of age, and a telescope like the Chandra X-ray telescope, because what happens in other wavelengths, as you know, you build a reflector or a lens, and you focus the radiation. And at the focus, you have a detector. Now, you can't have a mirror like this for X-rays, because X-rays will see this as completely hollow. It's like throwing sand in a tennis racket, it'll just go through. X-rays can only be reflected at grazing angle, like you throw stone in water. And so they're very difficult to make reflecting optics in X-rays. That was done in Chandra X-ray telescope. And that's why it cost $4 billion. And Chandra X-ray telescope is not only a reflecting telescope operating at X-ray wavelength, it also has an incredibly finely machined diffraction grating, a transmission diffraction grating in X-rays. So the technology of making these gratings is very complicated, because for visible light is a wavelength of 6,000 angstroms, so you can use a machine to draw lines in a piece of glass, but not if you want to use it in X-rays. So that you read about this is, so the spectacular progress that is made in astronomy is entirely due to progress in technology and material science. Okay, I don't think that enough credit is ever given to the engineering community for doing these things. So it is a masterpiece. This Chandra X-ray Observatory has a fantastic transmission grating. Look at this. Here is the spectrum of the ejecta: oxygen, neon, magnesium, silicon, sulfur, argon, calcium, iron. Just like in a Bunsen burner flame, except this is in X-rays. And the temperature of the gas is 10 million degrees or more. Not only that, because you're using a transmission grating, different orders correspond to different wavelengths. These different elements are at different wavelengths. So I can use a transmission diffraction grating of the Chandra telescope to form an image of this object in a particular wavelength. A particular wavelength which corresponds to iron or calcium or sulfur or silicon. When I first got interested in astronomy, if you had said this to me, I would say this is absolute science fiction. Absolute science fiction. A diffraction grating in X-rays? A reflecting imaging telescope in X-rays? There it is. Cassiopeia A, this is the total X-ray intensity, in different wavelength, the line of silicon, sulfur, calcium, iron. You know exactly not only how much of each element is, you know exactly where they are. Okay? So my friends, astronomy is exciting today, not because of theoretical progress, but because of experimental discoveries made. And technology and engineering have played a very important role in this. And this expanding debris goes on expanding and expanding, expanding. So you have giant bubbles of many light years. And as it expands, it encounters clouds of gas, atomic gas, molecular gas. It engulfs clouds and evaporates them. As it hits a cloud, it shocks the cloud collapses. As a result of the collapse, stars are born. Therefore, molecular clouds, which are clobbered by the expanding debris of supernovae, are the nursery for new stars. Till 1962, God created the heaven and the earth, a good book says, right? People knew stars were dying. But if trees are being cut, if the forest is still there, new trees must be born. new stars must be born. If you had said that, you'll be thrown out of the room. This is nonsense. How can new stars be born? And then came the major discovery in 1962 of very young stars. And then with the advent of millimeter wave astronomy, you actually could pierce the molecular cloud and see stars being born. These are exciting things that are happening today in astronomy. Okay? So, these expanding bubbles excavate huge cavities in the interstellar medium. We, our star and us, are inside one such medium, bubble. Bubble created by a star that exploded a long time ago. When a star explodes, there is a lot of gamma rays, ultraviolet, X-rays, and so on. Maybe the origin of life on Earth has something to do with that. I don't know how many of you have seen this old movie, Frankenstein's Monster. You put together in the graveyard, hands and legs, and then finally you will notice there is some lightning that comes. Okay, so we know that you need some high energy photons for this. So people have speculated whether the origin of life in Earth itself or in the comets which brought life to Earth might have been influenced by explosion of a nearby star. These are still speculations, but it's not nonsensical speculation. Okay? But the important thing to appreciate is we are inside a local bubble. Now, these bubbles accelerate clouds, they evaporate clouds, so that interstellar medium is a dynamic medium. You see the birth of stars, you see the death of stars, you see the nursery of stars where stars are being born. Previously, astronomers looked at the interstellar medium with long focal length still cameras. You see this, or you see this, or you see that at one particular wavelength. Then if you zoom out, you see the whole thing. And then if you make the still camera into a movie camera, you see one evolving into another. You see the symbiosis between the birth and death of stars. And the interstellar medium is extremely violent. In our galaxy, a star, massive star explodes once in 25, 30 years, depositing 10 to the power 52 eggs of energy. Okay? This picture emerged only in the late 1980s. Before that, we didn't know about all that. One had to wait for X-ray and gamma ray astronomy. Now, very briefly, in a couple of minutes, we will recall what I said about very massive stars, because that is going to be important for our discussion of which stars become black holes. So let's recall what we said. Chandrasekhar's 1932 paper, log of the pressure versus log of the density. This is the non-relativistic degeneracy curve. This is the relativistic degeneracy curve, rho to the power 5 by 3, rho to the power 4 by 3. And that is the ideal gas for 2% radiation pressure. In this regime, it is ideal. In this regime, degeneracy becomes important. First non-relativistic degeneracy, then relativistic degeneracy. But when the radiation pressure becomes 9.2% of the total pressure, the two pressures become equal, and when the radiation pressure exceeds 9.2% of the total pressure, the gas remains classical. An appeal to Fermi-Dirac statistics to avoid the central singularity cannot be made. Therefore, these stars, the cores will go on evolving, and when the nuclear reaction stops, the iron will not become degenerate. Because the iron core is inert, it will collapse. Other things will fall in. It will collapse and collapse and collapse. So, we said in the last lecture, these stars will become white dwarfs, about 1.4 solar mass. These stars will become neutron stars up to a certain critical mass. The mass is determined by when the radiation pressure reaches 9.2% of the total pressure. And therefore, stars more massive than this critical mass will collapse to singularities. Yeah? So in the next lecture, we will postpone that discussion for a couple of lectures. And in the next lecture, what we will do is to go on a journey from the surface to the interior of a neutron star and discuss the physics of the interior of neutron star. A lot of beautiful physics, including superconductivity and superfluidity. So we'll stop on that note, and I'll be happy if there are questions. Yes? Just one second. Yes, go on. There is no process. I mean, there is no difference. We don't know the details yet. When you have a giant molecular cloud, what is inside that is mainly hydrogen molecules and other molecules like carbon monoxide and other molecules. They are very few in number. You cannot study hydrogen molecule very easily because the hydrogen molecule is a symmetric molecule. Therefore, it does not have a permanent electric dipole moment. Therefore, infrared spectrum doesn't exist. Except you have to go to ultraviolet and so, which you can do now, but when the story began, you couldn't do that. So astronomers looked at carbon monoxide molecule and studied its rotational levels of carbon monoxide. But for every 100,000 hydrogen molecule, there is only one carbon monoxide molecule. But radio astronomy receivers are so sensitive that that is good enough. So you study carbon monoxide as a tracer, but remember it's mainly hydrogen. Okay. So I have a blast wave which hits it, supernova blast wave. And so this region is shocked and it collapses. So if I look at this after some time, when this shock wave has gone here, what I will find here are newly formed stars. What I'll find is a cluster of stars. Okay? So individual stars are not born. A cluster of stars are born. We see them in the sky, Pleiades, Hyades, so many clusters of stars. You're going to look. So if you then ask, what is the number of stars whose mass is m or greater than m as a function of the mass of the star? Then you find it's a sloping curve. And this is called as the initial mass function. So what this tells you is that there are more low mass stars formed and less high mass stars are formed. So it happens together. Then this cluster of stars slowly expands. And then after a long time, it loses identity as a bound cluster. When it is still young, when it's only a few million years old, you can still see it as a cluster. Okay, so the answer to your question is, stars of all masses are formed. It's not only low mass star.
When a low mass star forms, how it stops? Like, why can't it grow to the high mass star? What are the limits?
It's not like that. A region of the gas collapses. And that defines, see, the problem, we don't understand the formation of stars in detail because as the gas, see, everything in the universe is rotating. Everything has angular momentum. So as this gas cloud or portion of the gas cloud contracts, because of angular momentum conservation, it will go faster and spin faster. So the centrifugal force becomes important, which prevents further collapse. So you have to find a way to extract this angular momentum before it can collapse. We still haven't solved that problem theoretically, but nature seems to do it, right? So we don't understand the details of the collapse, but we have a broad picture, and we see this happening. Some gas can still fall onto it, but by that time, the distances are very large. You understand? So I don't understand this problem deeply. I don't think the problem is understood in the kind of detail that your question is asking, okay? Yes, you had a question.
So what are the differences in the light curves of type 1A supernovae and other types that make it that only these types count as standard candles?
No, it's not. It is not the... You're asking why these are standard candles?
And others are not.
And?
Others are not standard
candles. Ah, you see, the thing is, first of all, in other stars, they can have, ejecta can have all kinds of masses depending on the mass of the parent star, right? So what you see is the blanket, isn't it? Which is what you're seeing. And if the blanket has different amounts of mass, total light output can be very different. So there is nothing standard about the stars that explode themselves. Here, there is something very standard. Whereas the details are not known, we know that, suppose you take two unsolar mass stars merging, white dwarfs merging. You know the resultant is 1.4 solar mass neutron stars. And the remaining is ejected. The binding energy release is the binding energy released in the formation of the star. And because this mass which is ejected is rather small, in a normal massive star, what remains is a 1.4 solar mass. What is ejected is 10, 15 solar mass. It could be 10, 12 solar mass, 5, 8 solar mass. Here, the mass that is left behind is the dominant mass. 1.4 solar mass is, 1 plus 1, whatever is the neutron star of some mass. It could be 1, forget what I said, it's not 1.4 solar mass. Let us say 2 solar mass are formed. The neutron star will be 2 solar mass. A little bit is ejected, a thin skin is ejected. So people feel that the mass ejected is more or less standard. The amount of binding energy released is more or less standard. This may be the reason why it's a standard candle. People have not predicted this will be a standard candle. It came as a big surprise when they found they were standard candle. Now, I must confess that I have not followed the literature on type 1A supernovae and so on for a very long time. So I will not be able to tell you what is the latest thinking on why they are standard candles. Okay? You look, don't assume that I know the answer to all the questions that you might have. I just don't know. I just know that the possible variations are very small compared to when a massive star explodes. No, just a minute. There was a question here. Pass the microphone, please, somebody.
Sir, most of the cases, for the white dwarfs and other things, the outward force is balanced by the inward force, like the electron pressure and the radiation pressure by the gas and those things. But in some cases, we get approximated. So is there any possibility that there might be some unknown force, or has anybody ever postulated that there might be something, some unknown force which might be balancing it in approximate cases? I'm indirectly trying to ask about energy.
No, but why? What do you mean by dark energy balancing a star?
I mean, the scale that you are considering here is quite massive. So, in cases where we approximate that the inward pressure and the outer pressure and those things, in approximate cases.
See, I think you're confusing the fact. We use the term dark energy.
There's some unknown force, indirectly.
But there must be a reason why you suspect.
In approximate cases.
What approximate case? I don't know of any. All you can do is, in physics or chemistry or biology, You can take the sample and study it. You can vary the temperature, pressure, etc. in a controlled fashion. Astronomy is an observational science. You can only observe what is there to observe. And then you can build models. Now, people who build models, they build models on the basis of what we understand. It'll be rather silly to build models on some hypothetical thing which we don't even know exists. That'll be the hallmark of a very bad physicist who would do that. Models should be built within the premises of some known theory with known parameters. So I wouldn't build a model of something with some unknown springs. If I'm an engineer, I'll build a machine with known springs and known bolts and nuts.
No, I'm saying in approximate cases when...
I don't understand what you mean by approximate. You think about it. We'll come back to your question. Yes, pass the microphone, please.
So you said 1.4 solar mass neutron stars are formed in the core collapse supernovae.
Yes.
But we have observed neutron stars of higher masses. So are they formed only from type 1 supernovae?
No. No, not necessarily. Yeah, it's a good question. First of all, we don't know the masses very accurately in those cases. Okay. We only know masses of neutron stars in binaries, because then using Kepler's laws and relativity, we can calculate the mass exactly. We have calculated the mass up to 4 decimal places in some of those neutron stars. And they turn out to be 1.4 solar mass. Yes, some neutron stars have been found with 1.5, 1.6, 1.8 solar mass. But one shouldn't be surprised by that, because this theoretical scenario that I projected is a rather simple scenario where the core collapses, the rest is ejected. Now, some of the things which are escaping can decide to fall back on the neutron star. Some matter which, you know, the shock, whether the shock is created by the bounds of the core or by neutrinos or whatever it is, that shock may not be terribly efficient. So some matter can fall back. So initially, at T0, you have a neutron star of 1.4 solar mass, according to our theoretical picture. I wouldn't budge on that. Okay. But I wouldn't say that matter cannot fall onto it. And when matter falls onto it, what the surface gravity on the neutron star will be enormous, right? Therefore, the gravitational force acting on it will be enormous. So that matter will get neutronized. Even if you drop a ton of hydrogen, it'll all be neutrons. So the mass of the neutron star can be larger. In fact, it can become so large that it is not a neutron star at all. It becomes a black hole. That is how black holes are formed. Stellar mass black holes are formed that way. So if you think that is how stellar mass black holes are formed, then you shouldn't be surprised at finding a few neutron stars whose masses are more than 1.4 solar mass. Okay, it's a good, very good question you asked. Yes, so just pass the microphone, please.
Sir, you said that new stars are born, you know, with the ejectile interacting with the gaseous clouds, right? So it's like a star has to die or explode for new stars to form. So how are the primordial stars created, like the first stars?
We don't know. What you need is a gravitational potential well. Now that gravitational potential well into which the gas forms could be gravitational well provided by dark matter, not dark energy. We know there is dark matter, which is 70%, 80% of the mass in the universe. We don't know the depth of those gravitational potential wells. First of all, we don't know why spontaneously potential wells form. That is how we think galaxies form. Things fall into that potential well, and they become galaxies. So Martin Rees had speculated a long time ago that there could have been a generation of stars born before galaxies. Because if you look at the very distant quasars, the spectrum of very distant quasars, you see elements. And elements can only be synthesized in stars. So the question arises, how did these stars form before the galaxies formed? So we don't have a clear picture of that, either for how galaxies formed. It's one of the questions which is actively being pursued for the last 20, 30 years. But the formation of the first generation of stars, I would say, is even more difficult question. I know very little about it. All I know is there must have been, because we see in the spectrum of quasars, spectrum of the intervening gas in the quasars, that there have been stars because we see synthesized elements in the spectrum of quasars. Okay, I don't know the answer to your question. I think it's a very important and interesting question. Yeah, pass the nearby in the back so that we can then bring the microphone.
So for a star of around 15 solar mass, you said when the core becomes iron, after core becomes iron, a blast of neutrinos are produced.
No, when that core, that is not a blast. That is just a continuous emission of neutrinos.
Yes.
Lot of neutrinos are produced which cool the iron core.
Yes, yes.
Don't confuse that with this neutrino burst is when iron is converted to neutrons. Mm-hmm. That happens during the collapse. Okay, so that's a different neutron.
Enormous amount of neutrinos are produced. So why this process cannot occur before the core reaches?
Because all these things, the cross-section for the process to occur depends on also the energies. So it turns out that these things happen only when the gas is above a certain temperature. And those temperatures are reached only at that stage. Till then, in the star, for example, take the sun, for example, that produces neutrinos. That's a very simple process. If a proton becomes a neutron, emits a neutrino, and the first deuteron forms. That happens even at low energy, a temperature of 15 million degrees. But these processes that I mentioned, people who have studied them say these only happen at very high temperatures and very high energies. It's really the energy, temperature is a measure of the energy that you can attain, right? KT. Yeah, there was a question here. Take the microphone.
Sir, I wanted to ask about the neutronization. Like, if almost all protons are converted to neutrons, then how do we explain the magnetic field of neutron stars?
We will come to that in the next lecture.
Sir, in the observation of mass of neutron star slide that you showed us, there was quite some variation in the mass around 1.4. Like, there were neutron stars of masses less than 1.4. So how do we explain that?
No, but you have to look at error bars.
Oh.
All I'm saying is, you look at error bars. And that's a very old figure taken from some book. But if you look at, we will discuss two binary systems in the later lectures. There, we have measured the masses to 3 decimal places and 4 decimal places. Yeah. So those are early measurements and error bars. Over time, the error bar shrinks. Okay, so this is very old.
So is it possible that the blast, the pressure wave, can create high enough temperature inside some other star to start neutronization?
No, the impact of this blast wave on a shock on a star will be negligible because the cross section is very small. This molecular cloud is not 1 million kilometers in size, it's tens of light years in size. A molecular cloud mass will be 10 to the power 8 to 10 to the power 10 times the mass of the sun. These are gigantic objects in the interstellar medium. You're talking of a tiny thing, okay? It's like a solid versus an atom, practically. Yeah? Yeah, you can just speak up.
Uh, all the neutrons get converted into the protons?
Tomorrow, on Friday, we'll discuss that. His question is, if neutrons can decay in 1,000 seconds or so, why doesn't the neutron star decay? It's a very important question, okay? So we will discuss that next time. Yes.
Type 1A supernova, you said about the merging of two white dwarfs spiraling around each other. So how do they merge? Is it like a merging of two bubbles or like what?
What do you mean? Merging? It's like they gravitationally they are attracted to one another.
Yeah, for a particular distance they will be attracted, and during the merging, so they will merge like a bubble, like forming a.
Not like a bubble. Not like a bubble. They are solid objects. So it's like two pieces of clay. You bang them together.
Okay.
Yeah, of course they spiral in. How can they come radially? They have angular momentum. So you have to spiral in. You have to get rid of the angular momentum. And that's where gravitational waves are involved. Okay? You can't just come in. You need to get rid of that energy.
Okay.